today on Beyond 6 Seconds.
Well, Carolyn, my dream was that maybe one day I would become a general manager of a hotel. Never did I believe that I would ever own a property or as many properties as I own now. Never. Never, never, never.
Welcome to Beyond 6 Seconds, the podcast that goes beyond the 6-second first impression to share the extraordinary stories and achievements of everyday people. I'm your host, Carolyn Keel. On today's episode, I'm speaking with Harris Rosen, the president and chief operating officer of Rosen Hotels and Resorts. He is Florida's largest independent hotelier, having built a portfolio of 8 hotels in Orlando with close to 7,000 guest rooms over the course of 45 years. He is also a philanthropist who has created and funded initiatives to support local Orlando communities, including a program to provide free preschool and college scholarships to the youth of Tangelo Park and a similar initiative in the downtown Orlando Parramore district. He has been honored with the Coretta Scott King A.N.G.E.L. Award for his impact on Tangelo Park, and he believes that the successes of these local initiatives provide a template for uplifting America, one community at a time. Also joining us today is Chuck Dziuban, director of the Research Initiative for Teaching Effectiveness at the University of Central Florida, who works with Harris on the Tangelo Park project. Harris and Chuck, welcome to the podcast.
Oh, we're happy to be here.
Indeed, we're happy to be here. Thank you.
So happy to have you both here and to learn more about Harris's story and the impact that you're having on your local community. Harris, I'll ask you first, what inspired you to get into the field of hospitality?
Oh, it's a long story, Carolyn. My dad worked at the Waldorf Astoria. At that time, he referred to it as the Waldorf Hysteria. He was a sign painter. He came to me one day, and I was about 10 years old, I think. And he said, Harris, would you like to earn some money? Oh, well, of course I would. And he said, come to the office with Dad on Saturday, and I will show you what we have in mind. What we had in mind was Dad made the signs throughout the property. But he had an idea when there were fancy banquets, they would put place cards at the table and it would indicate where you would sit. The place cards were printed, and Dad thought that if he hand wrote the name, it would be a little bit more interesting. And so he convinced the banquet guys to let him try. Well, he had a beautiful handwriting, and he wrote the person's name on the card. He wanted to talk to me about earning some extra money, and he said, Harris, what I will like you to do is I will write the name of the person in pencil to make sure that I've spelled it correctly. Mm-hmm. Then I will go over the pencil with a crow quill pen and India ink, and then it'll dry. And then your job will be to fold the card, erase the pencil, and put it in a shoebox in alphabetical sequence. So I said, Dad, how much will you pay me for that? And he said, I'll give you a penny a card. I said, Dad, wait a second. I'm going to schlep all the way in from the neighborhood, missing punch ball, stick ball, ringle levio, to sit with you and earn 3 or 4 cents. He said, oh, no. Sometimes I do 300 or 400 cards. Wow. And I said, oh, my God, that's $3 or $4. Imagine how many crunchy bars, chunky bars I can buy and how many malted and egg creams. He said, yes. So I started. Now, here's why I got interested. I love the work. I love working in the hotel. But every once in a while, Dad and I would take the elevator either up or down to the appropriate ballroom to distribute the cards. This one day, we walked into the elevator, and there was a very tall, distinguished gentleman with the most beautiful blonde lady I'd ever seen in my life. And I whispered to Dad, can you introduce me, Dad? Now, I'm only about 10 years old. Mm-hmm. And he says, Harris, I would like you to meet Ambassador Kennedy, wow. Joe Kennedy, the father of the Kennedy boys. And I said, no, Dad, the lady. He said, wait. He said, Harris, I would like you to meet Marilyn Monroe.
Wow.
So she came over to me and gave me a hug. And I swear to God, Carolyn, if I close my eyes, I can still feel that hug.
Oh, wow.
Anyway, time goes by and I'm ready to apply for college. I went to music and art high school and was prepared to go to a fine arts college. But I thought about Marilyn. And I thought about the hotel business, and I said, Dad, would you be upset if instead of me applying to a fine arts college, I applied to a hotel school? He said, of course not. We did some research and discovered that Cornell had one of the best colleges of hospitality management. And I was accepted. And so I went to Cornell University, majored in hotel administration. And after 4 years, went into the Army after 3.5 years with Uncle Sam, started work at the Waldorf Astoria. And that's really how my career started.
So you started working back at the same location where you were helping your father?
That's right. Only when I applied, and I had left the Army as a first lieutenant, and I'd gone to jump school and had a lot of interesting experiences. But they said the only job they had for me was one that I was overqualified for. I said, I don't care. I will accept any job just to get started. They said, fine. The job was in the, they called it the personnel office, not HR. Mm-hmm. And that's where I started. The great advantage I had was I filed all of the new positions open. So all I had to do is take a position that I wanted before anyone else saw it, and I would then interview for the job. Within a month and a half, I was out of there, and up on the fourth floor where all of the sales meetings were, the smaller meetings, not the big ballrooms. And one day, a gentleman came over to me and he said, do you work here? And I said, yes, sir. He said, you work with all of these guys that are schlepping tables all over the place? I said, well, it was the only job that I thought would be appropriate for me as a starting job. He said, can I sit down and talk with you? And I said, yes. His name was Sal Lividini. He was the director of sales at the Waldorf Astoria. And he was stunned that I went to Cornell, stunned that I was an officer in the Army. And I was here moving tables around to set up for meetings. He said, the first job that is available in sales, I'm going to give it to you. Within a month or two, I moved into sales, and that was the beginning of my career.
That's amazing. And you've had an incredible career. Even before you started your own hotels, you started at the Waldorf Astoria. I know you moved around to several different properties. And I think at one point, didn't you wind up working at Disney?
Exactly. Here's what happened. I was on the Hilton Hotels management training program. And so they would let me work at a particular hotel for 3 or 4 months to learn certain skills. And so in a very short period of time, I had worked probably at around 5 or 6 Hilton hotels. Mm-hmm. Finally, I went from the East Coast. I went to Texas, to Dallas, and I was the assistant general manager at the Dallas Statler. While I was there, I met some very interesting people in Dallas because a lot of the folks held their events at the Statler. And I met one of the top real estate guys. He and I had a nice conversation. He heard all about my education, about my military service. And one day he came to me and he said, Harris, I just bought a hotel in Acapulco. Would you have an interest in managing it? I said, oh my God, yes. He said, well, you'll have to leave Hilton. I said, I know, but I'm ready to manage a hotel. And in Acapulco, that is a dream come true.
Oh yeah.
So we flew to Acapulco. I saw the property, fell in love with it. And the next thing I knew, I was in Acapulco managing Tres Vidas on La Playa, mm-hmm. a beautiful little motel that could accommodate about 200 or 300 people. It was beautiful, right on the ocean. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, about 6 months into my position, a new president was elected. His name was H.A. Faria. Mm-hmm. And he immediately changed a rule that affected me. The rule was, or the law was, that no longer could non-Mexican individuals own more than 49% of real property. So my boss, who owned 100% of Tres Vidas, so had to sell 51%. Mm. He sold it to a group of Mexicans. As soon as they bought that 51%, they fired me. Mm. And so off I drove into California and was heartbroken. I picked up the paper after I stayed one night. And much to my amazement, there was a story about Disney building a huge new attraction in Orlando. I was in California. Disney was located, their headquarters located in Burbank. Mm-hmm. So I drove over there and interviewed. They said, Harris, we're very interested in hiring you for a job in Orlando at the hotel division. We will make the final decisions in New York City. Well, I grew up in New York City. My mom and dad still lived in New York City. Mm-hmm. So I said, fine. I drove to New York City from California. Wow. And then I went to the hotel where they were interviewing. And I interviewed over lunch and waited a couple of days and was told that I was hired as a assistant individual of the hotel division, which was really wonderful. And so they told me when to come to California. Of course, I had my little car and I drove. on the way to California in Santa Fe, New Mexico, I was concerned that I would run out of money and wouldn't be able to buy gas. So I was drafting a very large semi. The semi made a very sharp turn in the mountains of Santa Fe. I went off the mountain.
Wow.
What saved my life was a tree stump that stopped my little Volkswagen from crumbling all the way down the hill. I was taken to the hospital, and 4 or 5 days later, after about 40 stitches in my head, I was told that I could leave, and I flew to California and started my career with Disney. After about a year, they flew me to Orlando, where they were finishing Disney World and the hotels. And that was the beginning of my career with Disney.
What an amazing, I don't want to call it an adventure, but such an incredible turn of events. And
if we ever meet each other, Carolyn, you'll be able to see the scar on my forehead.
Wow. Well, you just have an incredible way of taking any kinds of opportunities and finding different ways to take chances. When things change, just go and find other things to do within hospitality. And it seems like that's really served you well.
Well, look, it's fate. I mean, I lived, I didn't die, which was certainly a blessing. When we opened up Disney World in 1971, I think it was October, the hotels ran full. And so I anticipated that at some point in time, I would be called in by my boss and anticipated a very nice pay increase because the properties were doing so well. In 1973, I was still waiting for an increase and called in not by my boss, but my boss's boss, and was so excited and so happy. And the conversation started off beautifully. Harris, you've done a great job for us. And I said, oh, my God, this is going to be a great meeting. The next words were, but, and I'm saying to myself, why does but have anything to do with this? And he said, but we don't think, Harris said, you'll ever really become a Disney executive.
Wow.
What? Mm. Well, every once in a while, I do slip back, even till today, my old New York City East Lower East Side neighborhood. And I said, you said I'll never become a Disney executive. Is it because my ears are too small? Thinking like Mickey Mouse, and they wanted people with big ears. The guy didn't appreciate it, and he said, that's all. So I was fired.
Wow.
I then made up my mind that I could not work for anybody else, that I had to work for myself, because that was probably the third or fourth job I'd been fired from. So you may remember, Carolyn, there was an oil embargo in the early 70s.
Mm-hmm.
And imagine what an oil embargo did to the hotels in Orlando. Almost every one of them was bankrupt. But this genius said, now is the perfect time to buy a hotel.
Yeah.
They're cheap.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed, I did find a beautiful little Quality Inn located perfectly between Interstate 4, International Drive, and Sand Lake Road, 250 rooms. And I went over and asked if I could speak with the manager or the owner. And I was told the owner was there and he would be happy to speak with me. A very husky, short fellow came out to meet me and he said, come in the office, and we chatted. He said, what can I do for you? And I told him I was there because I was looking to buy a hotel. He got out of his chair, came around the desk, asked me to stand, and then hugged me. And he said, God has sent you.
Wow.
I said, oh my God, what is this all about? And then he shared with me a very touching story about himself, not knowing anything about the hotel business, but buying the hotel as a real estate investment. And having to fire everyone because property was doing so badly, and not able to see his three daughters for months because he was living at the hotel. So he looked at my resume. He said, oh, my God, God has really sent you. He said, I'm going to call the lender, and you and I and the lender will sit down and chat, and we'll see if we can work something out. He called me a week later. The lender was, I think, Travelers out of New York or Connecticut, and the gentleman came over. And we had a nice conversation, looked at my resume, he said, oh, my God, your resume is perfect. He said, how much money do you have in the bank, Harris? And I said, boy, that's a strange question to ask. Do I answer it correctly or not? I said, you better. So I said, I have about $20,000 I saved from my 3.5 years in the Army and my 4 years with Disney and Hilton. And he said, can I shake your hand? I said, sure. He said, we have a deal. You give me a check for $20,000 and you will assume a mortgage. I had no idea what assuming a mortgage was, but I shook his hand I gave him the $20,000, so I had no money in the bank. Wow. And I walked into my office on June 24th, 1974, and I cried. And I said, Harris, you just said the dumbest thing you possibly could do in your life. You gave away every penny you have, and you assumed a mortgage without even asking what assuming a mortgage is. Now you know. It's $2.5 million that you owe. Ooh. Anyway, I calmed down, had a strategy. I was going to hitchhike to New York City, to Massachusetts and New Jersey, where all of the motor coach companies were, mm-hmm. and sign up the motor coach companies by giving each company owner a card, a business card, and letting them write whatever room rate they wanted, because motor coaches were still able to get gas.
Oh.
So I hitchhiked from here to New York City, met with some of the top motor coach companies in New York. Then they drove me to New Jersey, met with the top motor coach company there. Then they drove me to Massachusetts, met with the top motor coach companies there. And in every instance, I gave the owner a card and said, this will be good for 2 years. The cards I still have, mm-hmm. the rates were $7.25, low rate. The high rate was $8.25 for 2 years. I was going to hitchhike back to Orlando. But I was told by the Paragon Tour owners in Massachusetts that they know of people who travel to Florida and they'll find someone to drive me. They did. A couple drove me to Orlando. That couple was my guest for a month every year until they passed away. So thankful was I that they didn't have to hitchhike back.
Wow.
And that's how it started. June 24th, 1974. I bought the property, and then several months later, I now had a list of motor coach companies that were going to use my hotel for 2 years at very low rates, but at least it was business.
That's amazing. Just having the foresight to think of that creative idea. Once you realized what you had gotten yourself into, you immediately went into a separate mode of thinking and said, what do I know? Who can I bring in to start bringing in money to this hotel? How did you know to go to the motor coach company? How did you get that idea?
Because I did see buses on occasion at various hotels. And I spoke to the bus drivers. I said, well, how do you get gas? I said, well, we're really the best customers they have when things are good. And so when things are not very good, they take good care of us so that we won't forget.
Mm.
And I said, oh, my God, so you guys are still coming? He said, yep. And I said, where are the big motor coach companies? He said, New York, New Jersey, and Massachusetts. And that's how it happened.
Wow. So you definitely have that entrepreneurial spirit and instinct. You always wanted to manage a hotel. And, you know, even though you had careers working in for other properties and hospitality, it sounds like this is something that really was within you that you wanted to do. And you had also that instinct to come up with ideas and make it happen. So that's incredible.
Well, Carolyn, my dream was that maybe one day I would become a general manager of a hotel. Never did I believe that I would ever own a property or as many properties as I own now. Never, 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 never. But there is an entrepreneurial gene, and I suspect I have it. It is a gene that is terrible because you work hard, hard, hard all the time, and you're never satisfied. You always want to do something more, and it's terrible. But I managed to survive so far and raise a family, and I've been blessed beyond anything I ever imagined.
That's wonderful. Yeah, I feel like these days there's a lot of romanticizing about entrepreneurship, and I feel like everybody wants to open their own business and it's the cool thing to do. But I'd imagine in the early to mid 70s, I don't think people really were excited or wanted to start their own businesses. I thought everybody just sort of wanted to be like a company man, as you were saying, or find that secure job at a firm and stay there.
It became apparent to me after I was fired from Disney that I was not a good company man.
Mm-hmm. Well, you took that one property and over the course of many years turned it into a whole collection of properties. So what was the decision behind purchasing the second property, the next way to grow?
Well, that's interesting. It soon became apparent to everyone here in Orlando that Rosen was doing something different in his little Quality Inn. Mm-hmm. Because I was busy all the time. There were motor coaches all over the property, parked all over the property. And lenders, because there weren't too many people still operating their hotels, lenders were in charge, would come over to me and they would talk to me and they say, would you be interested in buying our hotel? And I kept saying, no, 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 no. But at one point in time, a lender came over from Philadelphia and he mentioned a hotel down the street. He said, we need to do something with it because we're practically empty. And my boss has told me that I've got to do something with it. Would you like to buy it? Would you like to manage it? Please, Harris, do something. His name was Jim Connors. Mm-hmm. And I said, Jim, let me think about it. And then I came up with an idea and I called him into my little office and I said, I will manage the hotel for you guys for 5 years. At the end of 5 years, I will have an option to buy the hotel. During the 5 years, I will accept no management fee. You will match my management fee. And at the end of 5 years, we will see if I have accumulated enough for me to at least make a good down payment or maybe even purchase the property. We negotiated a purchase price and I began. The hotel was valued at a fraction of what it was worth when I signed the agreement with Mr. Connors. Mm-hmm. And so the management fee doubled at the end of 5 years was enough to pay off the mortgage.
Wow.
And so at the end of 5 years, I owned the little property, which we renamed the International Inn. And so in 5 years, I had two hotels, one of them no debt, the other one operating at about a 95% occupancy. And that was the beginning.
That's amazing. Was there ever a point in your career as an entrepreneur that you said, this is really going to grow into something very, very big, you know, in terms of accumulating properties and continuing to have these properties with low or no debt, but very high occupancy, bringing good revenue in?
The answer is no. And I just remember the name of the bank. It was the Continental Bank of Philadelphia, Jim Connors. Anyway, No, I did one step at a time. I expanded the little Quality Inn that I bought first and going from 256 rooms to 728 rooms. I expanded the little International Inn from 251 rooms to 325 rooms. And then business started picking up and I acquired land. And I built another hotel, acquired land, built another hotel, and it just kept mushrooming until I wound up with about five properties. And then it was just a question of adding on to properties and adding on to properties, which I've been doing over the years. And then recently, about 13, 14 years ago, I built the Shingle Creek Resort, which is the largest property I have of 1,501 rooms.
That's incredible. It's step by step. And now you have, oh my goodness, like 7,000 guest rooms that you've built.
We have about 7,000 guest rooms. And here's a funny story, Carolyn. Mm-hmm. We have no debt.
Wow.
And I'll tell you why. I grew up in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. My mom's family came from Austria. My dad's family came from Russia, mm-hmm. Belarus. And my two granddads were successful businessmen. One had a wooden barrel factory and the other had a tiny little restaurant on the Lower East Side. Unfortunately, they lost everything during the Depression. So I'm about 7 or 8 years old, and I'm sitting with my two granddaddies, and they say in very thick Eastern European accents, they say, Boychik, you have something very special in your genes, and you're going to be a successful businessman. And I said, wow, thank you, Grandpa. But we want to tell you, don't ever borrow money. Because your two granddaddies borrowed money and we lost everything. Mm-hmm. So don't borrow money. Okay. So I had that in my mind. I have something special in my genes and don't borrow money. So I go to bed that night, my brother and I, in our little bedroom. And mom always tucked us in. So she was tucking me in and she said, why aren't you wearing your PJs? Why do you have your jeans on? Mm-hmm. And I said, oh, because my two granddaddies said I had something special in my jeans. No, Mom said, different kind of jeans. I'll explain to you later, but not these jeans. You can put your PJs on. So anyway, about 15 years ago, I said, you know what? I'm going to remember my two granddads and I'm going to pay off all my debt, which we did. So today we don't have a penny of debt.
That's amazing because it seems like such a given now that people, when they're building businesses, take on debt and there's all this talk of good debt and bad debt, but it's kind of refreshing to hear that you found a different way to do it.
We don't do that. We have a piggy bank and when we have enough money in the piggy bank, we buy, we build, we add on whatever we do.
Wow. You know, you've had an incredible career as an entrepreneur over many decades and you know, at a certain point, you became a philanthropist on top of running a whole hotel empire. Was there a certain incident or a certain thought that you had that really inspired you one day to start pursuing philanthropy?
So, Carolyn, where I'm sitting right now, I've been here for 45 years in this little office. It was where I lived for 16 years until I got married. And now it is my office. And I was sitting here at my desk, and suddenly, this is about 30 years ago, I heard a voice. It said, "Harris, you've been blessed beyond anything you've ever imagined. It's now time for you to offer a helping hand to those in need." Wow. I said, "Oh my God, isn't that interesting? But what kind of a helping hand and to whom?" So when I was growing up, my mom and dad spoke a lot about education and that if my brother and I ever wanted to leave the neighborhood, the best way out was to get a good education. So I said, "I'll call a couple of friends of mine who I got to know." One was the principal of a local high school, Dr. Phillips High School, and that was Bill Spoon. And the other was a lady I'd met who was an expert in early childhood education. And they sat at my desk and I explained to them about the voice I heard and that I thought it was time for me to start offering a helping hand. Within a very short period of time, we created a program that would provide free preschool for all youngsters in a neighborhood and then offer college, trade school, or community college to all of the youngsters in the neighborhood so that they would have an opportunity to really enjoy what America was all about. The only thing we didn't have was a neighborhood. And that didn't take very long. One of the county commissioners, Mabel Butler, I called her and she said, "Harris, I'll come right over and I will drive you to the perfect neighborhood where you can start this program." Mabel drove me to a little neighborhood called Tangelo Park, which was only about a half hour from my office, introduced me to the principal of Tangelo Park Elementary School. And he and I had a wonderful chat. And he said, "Harris, why don't you offer your program to the neighborhood? And I'll invite all of the families to come and meet in our assembly, and you can talk to them and mention what it is that you have in mind." So I said, "Oh my God, Dr. Allen, that's wonderful." So the day came and the auditorium was full, standing room only, and Dr. Allen introduced me and I started talking about what I wanted to do. I noticed, though, that people didn't seem overly enthusiastic. Mm-hmm. So I tried to think of what was I saying that might be confusing. And it came to me that if I was saying that this program would start at 3 and then I would take care of everyone going to college, that everyone there might think, "Well, what if I have a 5-year-old or a 10-year-old or a 13-year-old? Mm-hmm. What's going to happen? If I don't have a 3-year-old, I'm not going to be able to take advantage of the program." Mm-hmm. So I said, wait, everybody. I think I know what's wrong. And I said, "In June, any of you who have youngsters in college, I will start paying their tuition. Any of you that have youngsters in high school ready for college, I will take care of their tuition. 3, 4, 5, I will take care of all of the 2, 3, and 4-year-olds, and we will have opportunities for the youngsters in the other grades to begin learning so that they're ready for high school, because I want high school graduation rates to be as close to 100% as possible." The place went crazy. And we started the program just about 27 years ago. And Chuck can give you all of the data in terms of how incredibly successful the program has been.
That's amazing. So Chuck, I'll toggle over to you. I'd love to hear about some of the successes and the impact that the Tangelo Park project has had.
Well, Carolyn, I'd be happy to share some of the things that we have with this, but I want to comment that I have known and worked with Harris for 26 years, and I love hearing his story. And every time he tells it, I learn something new. Mm-hmm. It's just an amazing kind of story. And I think one of the things that I hope your listeners take from this podcast is that entrepreneurial spirit applied to philanthropy creates a synergy and an energy like nothing we've ever experienced before. I'll go back 26 years to Tangelo. It was a dangerous place. Mm-hmm. Drugs, crime, prostitution. Bob Mellon, the principal, would tell his teachers to go home immediately after school. Don't stay on the property. That's what Tangelo was. That's what Harris entered 26 years ago. That was a community that was in trouble. It had no hope. I can tell you, we struggle with the problem. What is the problem in this country? If you live in the lower economic quartile, the chance of your graduating from college is 10%. The odds against you are 9-1. Mm. It's almost certain failure. It's totally unacceptable. Harris will tell you later, and he believes, and I do, we are wasting millions of minds in this country, and we can no longer afford to do it. Fast forward to 26 years later, with the pieces that have been put into place, early childhood education. The beginning early childhood education program was an in-home program. Harris provided for, refitted homes, trained residents. They ran in-home preschool programs within the community. It was a perfect situation for a community like this. They knew the community, they trusted them, they were qualified, and that worked. It worked extremely well for many, many years. These children at 2 years of old, by the time they were in kindergarten, they were reading. I mean, the progress was amazing. We like to say in Tangelo, working with the Rosen Foundation and the University of Central Florida, that the first year of college begins at 2 years of age. We know how important that is, and we began to do that. The program, again, is the early childhood education, moving on to Head Start, VPK, kindergarten, being supported all the way through elementary school, all the way through middle school, all the way through high school, and then when you get to college, a full scholarship, wow, room, board, and tuition to any state university in Florida, any community college, any vocational school of your choosing. This is a completely 2 to 22-year-old program, supported, and we've used the word in the past, and we don't use it anymore, and Harris will tell you why, in perpetuity. Mm-hmm. As long as a community exists, the program will be there. That's the important part of this kind of experience. Some of the things that have happened over the years, and I would say the early childhood program is so important because we not only train children in terms of knowledge acquisition, but executive function, how to control their emotions, how to work with other people, and social emotional skills, those three components. James Heckman, Nobel laureate, has just shown in a landmark study that not only the children who had preschool, but the children of those people have a better life. They have a better life. It is so important. Given that, I would expect, and it's hard to find the data of 26 years ago, but the graduation rate in Tangelo was approximately 60% in high school. Mm. Totally unacceptable. Mm. Totally unacceptable. Today, in Tangelo, the graduation rate from high school is 100%.
Wow.
It is true in this country that if we can move the high school graduation rate in this country 1 year to 90%, it will add $10 billion to the United States economy. And I can tell you why as we get further into this kind of thing. The GPAs that are up, high school graduation, as I said, is 100%. Crime is down 78% in Tangelo. Wow. Over the 26 years. Mayor Demings, who was then Sheriff Demings, has said now that Tangelo is an oasis. Crime is not there. Those students who remain in Tangelo and accept the scholarship graduate from college at a rate of 78%. That is higher than almost any demographic in the country. Mm. Go back to what the expectation would be, 10%. Do you see what has happened in this community? It has been a complete turnaround. People often collect the wrong data, the wrong metrics on communities like this. They say this. They say, okay, how many graduated from high school? How many went to college? How many graduated? Divide and give me the percentage. Mm-hmm. It's the wrong metric. The expectation of the somewhat around 500 graduates we have today, but remember, if there were no Tangelo Park program, we would have far fewer than 500 high school graduates. The expectation would have been 45 students would have attained a college degree. We have produced to date 157 college graduates and produced 224 college degrees. Mm-hmm. The odds originally would have been 9-1 against. Today in Tangelo, with the Rosen program, the odds of you getting a college degree are almost 4-1. We have degrees in 37 fields. We have awarded at UCF the first two students who will be accepted in our medical school will receive full rides to medical school. There is zero debt for any of these students. These students leave college with zero debt. College debt is crippling our undergraduate population.
Yes.
We talk to people and talk to people and talk to people, and what they continually say to us, we need more data. We need more data. Mm. We need more data. And we've come to understand that that's a euphemism for they don't want to do it. Mm. Harris will tell you why people really don't want to replicate this kind of program. So one of the things that was asked was, what is the ROI on this program? This is a program about business and entrepreneurial spirit. Mm. We want to know what is the return on investment. For Harris is approximately $14 million over 26 years in Tangelo. We hired an economist from the University of Chicago to do a return on investment study, and his conservative estimate was that for every $1 invested in Tangelo, $7 goes back to the American society. Mm-hmm. The return on investment is 7-1. That is nothing short of amazing in terms of things. We know that this program works. Harris's frustration, you talk about it, we can't get anyone else to use this kind of an entrepreneurial spirit where you say, I'm in this for the long haul. I'm not funding this for 3 years and then you're on your own. Mm. He was so frustrated with this, he'll tell you about that, he's now done another community. Parramore, Central Orlando, five times the size. We know that the outcomes will be just as dramatic. It is the new philanthropy. It is tied to his and the Rosen Foundation entrepreneurial spirit. We are, again, wasting millions and millions of minds in this country. The talent pool in these underserved communities is as deep as any gated community in this country. We must turn that around. This is the outcome. And I hope your readers will contact us. We'll give you the information. You can have all the data. You can have all the data that I have. Carolyn, it costs about $12,000 a year to educate a student. It costs twice that to incarcerate a student. Mm-hmm. We just have to turn this around. This program works. Parramore will work. And I'm so grateful for you for listening to our story. Harris, do you want to add anything to this?
Well, yeah, what I add is that for too long, and I can be stubborn on occasion, Chuck was advising to collect data and to publicize our success. And I said, yeah, I feel very uncomfortable doing that. And I wasted too many years by being stubborn. Now, the great frustration that we feel is, even though in the past, let's say, decade or so, we have spoken with individuals representing some of the wealthiest individuals in America or some of the largest foundations in America, not one of them has indicated a interest in replicating the program, something that we have no understanding of whatsoever. We had no idea why they weren't interested. I suspect it might have something to do with the fact that it's a program that is not a 1 or 2 or 3 year program. And that might be something that they feel is a bit prohibitive. I'm not sure. But for us, we don't care how long it's going to take. We have the patience. We will wait and we will see the results and be so pleased with the results. In fact, that proudest and happiest day of my year, every year, is when I attend the preschool graduation at Tangelo and Parramore. Mm. It's so incredibly wonderful. What I do is I move, because they have their little caps and gowns, I move the tassel, I hand them their diploma, and I wish them Godspeed. And that's so wonderful. I tell the moms, the dads, the grandparents, get ready. This is just the beginning. This is preschool. You've got kindergarten. You've got elementary school. You've got middle school. You've got high school. You've got college. You've got graduate school. You're going to attend a lot of graduations. Mm. But what we're wasting is so sad. It is so pathetic. High school dropouts account, we've been told, for $90 billion in criminal activity. Mm. That's so sad, so pathetic. There's no reason for it. just helped them graduate from high school and create an incentive for these wonderful kids to go to college. Why can't we do it? It's crazy.
And you figured out how to do it. So the challenge is how to get people to think differently enough and make the investments that you've made in their communities.
And you know, Carolyn, what I learned a lot in the Army, one of the things I learned was KISS. Keep it simple, stupid. Mm-hmm. This program isn't complicated at all. Wow. It's so easy. We can help people set it up in no time. And the changes, the philosophical changes and the educational opportunities that are provided in underserved communities are really quite extraordinary. And what we do is we say this. If every underserved community in America had a Tangelo or a Parramore program, we would not recognize the United States of America. So sad.
It sounds like you've taken it upon yourself to replicate your own model. And, you know, we've mentioned the Parramore project a couple times, something that's
exactly
about
right.
five times the size.
Carolyn, over five or six times the size.
Wow.
And also a community that is in desperate need of help. But as Chuck says, we will see the same success in Parramore that we've seen in Tangelo Park. And that will happen in every single underserved community in America.
That's amazing. And it's exciting to see that. I know Parramore, it sounds like, is a newer project, but that you're already seeing some positive impact from that program as well. Is that correct?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Our goal, of course, is look, high school graduation is the key. If a youngster graduates from high school, he or she will earn over a lifetime $500,000 more than if he or she did not graduate from high school. That is absolutely essential. So that is the hurdle that we have to overcome. Let us encourage and help these youngsters graduate from high school. Some may want to go to trade school, paid for. Mm-hmm. Some may want to go to community college, paid for. Some may want to go to college, paid for. It is not complicated, Carolyn. Mm-hmm. It is not complicated. You don't have to have a certain grade point average. You don't have to live in a certain place. No. If you're in this neighborhood, you qualify, period.
It certainly seems simple enough. Yeah. And what a wonderful impact on not just the students, but it uplifts the whole community. And you really see that with your projects that you've done.
No doubt about it. No doubt about it. A turnover in the neighborhood, which used to be really quite incredible, because we would be teaching a youngster and then that youngster would disappear. Mm. But now it hardly exists at all. Why? Because people understand what a gift it is to live in a community where that you have preschool for all of the children, and then you have an opportunity to go to college, and virtually every youngster will graduate from high school. That's so important.
Absolutely. You know, you clearly have such a strong passion about this and a really wonderful model that you want to get out there. How can people get in touch with you to learn more about your work or support you in your goals for what you want to do with education and philanthropy?
Chuck, do you want to answer that?
I will. If any of your listeners want to come see us, want to come visit, want to meet with the Tangelo citizens, want to in Parramore, we are more than happy to host people here. And if there are some people who are interested, I will be happy to go anywhere and talk to people about what is accomplished in this particular community and these two communities. James Baldwin has a great quote. He said, if you ever grown up in poverty, you know how terribly expensive it is to be poor.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a very prophetic statement in terms of what these people are facing without a little bit of help. And unfortunately, in this country, those funding crickets chirp in 3-year cycles. 3-year programs do not work. Mm-hmm. They cannot work. You have to do what we have done here. You must be in it for the long haul. We did not see a change in crime rates for 5 years, but because we stayed the course, we were able to achieve those kinds of things. We will send you notes. We would love to have people come and visit. They will be astounded.
Wonderful. Well, I hope that my listeners who are interested in education and uplifting people from poverty and enhancing our communities will take you up on that offer. And I will absolutely share your contact information in the show notes of this podcast. So thank you.
And Carolyn, let me say one more thing.
Yes.
This is not a program to be financed by the public sector. The United States of America, probably this moment, is around $24, $25 trillion in debt. Enough is enough. Turn to the private sector. Thousands and thousands of multi-billionaires in America. Ask them to get off their tush and adopt a community. And you know what? If they have a tiny little speck of greed, they can satisfy that. Because when these children graduate from high school and some from college, the economy will absolutely explode. So I don't care what business they're in, they're going to be the beneficiary.
That's really important for people to remember. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for reminding us all of that importance and emphasizing and really having a call to action for people who have those funds, who have been fortunate in their lives to follow a similar path and have a similar revelation that you had when you realized, you know, it was time to share your good fortune and improve the world around you. So thank you for doing that.
Thank you, Carolyn. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thanks for listening to Beyond 6 Seconds. Please help us spread the word about this podcast. Share it with a friend, give us a shout out on your social media, or write a review on Apple Podcasts or your favorite podcast player. You can find all of our episodes on our website and sign up for our free newsletter at www.beyond6seconds.com. Until next time.